Hey guys, so today we'll talk about simple linear regressions, and by the end of the video you'll understand the practical applications and what the beta coefficients mean. So let's get started. So let's start off with an example. We have our graph, the x and y axis as always, with the x axis being the independent variable, the y being the dependent as always. But let's call the x-axis age, and the y-axis the dependent variable height. Now, for the sake of this example, let's say that the age starts off at 0 and will only go to about 15. Like when people stop growing, I think most stop by the time of 15. And we take a sample of a bunch of people, and we plot everybody's age against everybody's height, right? And we'll get something like this. We have a whole bunch of random dots, right? And it will look like something like this, right? Because obviously, as you get older, you become taller. Now, what is a regression? A linear regression is when we try to draw a line to match these points. So obviously, at first glance, this line would look something like this, right? And the equation for that line would be in the same format that you're used to with a linear equation. Y hat equals beta 0 plus beta 1 x plus the error term. Now, this is where a lot of people get confused. Let's break it down piece by piece. So this is in the same format of a linear equation that you're used to, right? We're all used to y equals a plus bx, where a is the intercept and b is the slope, right? Well, this is really the same thing. We have the intercept right here, so beta 0 is the same as the intercept, and b and beta 1 is the slope, so this is the same thing. And x is x, the independent variable. What do the little hats mean? The little hats mean that it's an estimated, it's an estimator. So this y, this line that we draw here, it's estimated. It's not the true line, obviously, of all the points. Same with the beta 0, we estimate it, and same with the beta 1. Now, epsilon, the error, is how much off the line each point is. And it really, it's just like a notation. It's not really part of the equation, so to speak. So if you were to graph it, you don't really graph the error. But here's what it breaks down to. The line that we draw, each point will be a certain distance away from the line, right? It'll either be above or below a certain distance, right? And what a linear regression is, and well, I don't need to draw them, you get the idea. What a linear regression is we want to draw a line that minimizes the sum of the squares of these distances. That's why it's called ordinary least squares, because we want to draw a line where the distance from each of the data points, if we square all these little lines and we add them together, we want that number to be as small as possible. Because that means we drew a line that fits the best, right? Now, let's look at another example. Obviously, height and age correlate to a certain point. I mean, obviously, if we kept going, if we did this past 15, it would kind of slow down because people aren't really growing in their 30s and 40s, right? So it sloped upwards and then it would just stop and go like this, right? That makes sense. Now, let's take a look at something that wouldn't really make any sense. So let's say that we have the same thing, but now we have people's weight and test scores, right? If we say took a bunch of college students, we weighed each one of them and we look at their GPA, for example, right? That would be all over the place. There would be no correlation whatsoever, right? So that line that you would draw, it would not have any slope. It would just go like this. Right through, it would be a flat line because it doesn't make any sense. There's no correlation between how much somebody weighs and how smart they are, right? How well they do on tests. It would be ridiculous, right? But it doesn't necessarily have to be through the center. It could be somewhere up here or somewhere down here. It really depends on the population sample that we take. I mean, if we take a bunch of really smart kids, obviously this would all be shifted up, right? Because their test scores would be higher and therefore the line, the best fit line would go up higher. Likewise, if we take a bunch of F students or C students, right, that line would be down below because their test scores would be shifted, right? This makes sense. Now, let's break down what these beta coefficients mean. How are they defined? Like I said before, it's the sum of least squares. So what does that mean? We have the main line. First, we start up with beta 1. Beta 1 is defined, here, I forgot the hat, because like I said, it's estimated. It's the sum of all the data points starting with 1 to n. Now, this isn't the same symbol, right? Because this confused me at first. This is like a little pointy symbol, and this is n, meaning the number of observations that we have. And it's xi-th minus x bar times yi-th minus y bar divided by, this should be like this, divided by, this is all one term, divided by the sum of all the observations, xi-th minus x bar squared. That's where the sum of least squares comes in. Now, let's break this down. First of all, if you're not sure how to read sums, then check out the video that we did on sums. I think it's explained pretty well. And x bar and y bar here are just the averages. Pretty simple. The averages. So if we take all the ages or all the weights and we average it, that's what x bar is. And the same with y bar. If we take all the test scores and we take all the heights and average them, that's what it is. Pretty straightforward. And beta 0 is then defined by using beta 1. It's y bar, the average, minus the beta 1 estimator times x bar, right? So these are the two variables that we use. And then you just write plus epsilon plus the error term, because obviously there will always be a little bit of an error. Now, what's a real-world example? Obviously, we can't do an example here because it would take me forever to write out. I mean, this board would not be enough. This is usually done using some sort of statistical software. I prefer Stata or Python. But an empirical result that was found is called Oakens Law. And what does Oakens Law tell us? We have the same graph, right? And in this case, the independent variable is the percent change in unemployment. And the dependent variable is the percent change in GDP. And what it tells us is that, here, it's 0 here and 0 here, minus 1, 1, and it's percent change. So it's not the actual unemployment rate and not the actual GDP, but the change of quarter over quarter or year over year. Usually it's done in quarters, so 4 times every year. And what it tells us is that if we take a bunch of countries and we plot their percent change in unemployment that they see over time, we come up with something like this, right? And the line will go through like this, and the law states that for every, plus 2, for every 1% change in unemployment, so for every 1% of unemployment going up, plus 1% unemployment leads to a minus 2% change in GDP, which is pretty intuitive if you think about it. If people aren't working, they're not making money, they are not spending money, therefore their economy is slowing down. But the fact that it's double is pretty interesting. And this was done empirically, obviously, because it's not something you can derive theoretically. So that's it. This is an intro to what linear regressions are. We'll definitely talk more about this topic because there's a lot to cover. I hope you guys like this video. Don't forget to click like, subscribe to our channel, check out more videos, and stay geekly, my friends.